Good morning, guys. Thanks so much for turning out here today. So the panel is going to be about the long march of a founder, a person. You know, we talk a lot about the initial disruption. You know, there's a whole euphoria when a new company gets started, but very few people really talk about the long march of a company, the stage when the company is trying to pivot from just an initial disruption to actually a sustainable business. So the aim of this panel today is to talk a little bit about that. We have a great set of panelists today. Amongst the panelists, we have Mr. Vishal Gupta, who is on the extreme right, who's going to be the moderator for the panel. He's the managing director of one of India's leading technology investment venture funds, BVP, Bessemer Venture Partners. We have Mr. Rajiv Luthra at the very left, who is the founder and managing partner of Luthra and Luthra Law Offices, one of India's largest full-service law firms, and has over three decades of experience as a lawyer, a personal advisor, and even a corporate advisor to some of the most leading companies in India. We have Mr. Abhiraj Bhal, who is the founder and CEO of Urban Clap, the largest services marketplace in India today, and one of the fastest growing Indian tech startups. We have Mr. Murugavel Janakiraman, who is the founder and CEO of BharatMatrimony.com, which is India's largest online matrimony website. We have Mr. Anuj Srivastav, who is the CEO and co-founder of LiveSpace, India's first home interior design platform. And we have Mr. Vivek Prabhakar, who is the CEO and co-founder at Chumbak. You've all heard about Chumbak, I'm sure. We've all heard about this company. So this is the panel that we have today. And over to Vishal, who's going to lead the panel.
Great. Thanks, Anant. So I thought we will cover a few things. One is just talk to each one of our panelists and talk a little bit about their own journey into entrepreneurship. And maybe we can start with you, Rajiv. You are the oldest entrepreneur, the first entrepreneur in India, in some sense, on this panel at least, started in 1990. Not as a lawyer, but can you talk a little bit about your journey as an entrepreneur over the last 27, 28 years, and what's been your experience so far running a legal law firm in India?
Sure. Good morning, all. I object to him calling me the oldest. You can say I'm the largest. That's fine with me. But that works. So guys, I have a pretty weird story that I started, and I don't think there's another parallel, at least I've not heard of it. So I was one of those real overconfident kids in school. And the worst marks I got was in the top three in our class. I never got fourth. And I was sure I'd be an engineer, and I only applied to IIT Delhi. I decided nobody else is good, not IIT Delhi. Of course, being overconfident, I did not read the fine print. It said 16 rupees 50 paise in a demand draft or a pay order. I went there to the to IIT Delhi, gave them 16 rupees 50 paise as cash. Of course, that was pocketed. Everybody else got their admit cards. I didn't. I went back crying to the dean, everything, but nothing worked. My father was in the Air Force, but a refugee from Lahore, and he qualified as a chartered accountant in 1947, October. They came in July of 47 to Delhi, and he qualified in October. But being a good accountant, he was getting 180 rupees a month in the audit, in the chartered accountancy in the profession, and he was getting 220 rupees in the Air Force. So the accountant joined the Air Force, served for 20 years, and then set up his chartered accountancy practice. Now, I didn't get into engineering, so I did my BCom, got in very earlier on into became, in fact, even till today, I'm the youngest admitted article clerk in the Institute of Chartered Accountants in India. And then went on to finding that auditing is the most brain-dead activity any human could do. But went on to do it. It was father's firm, and he was a lovely man. He passed away a few years ago. A lovely man, and he would say, and I'd keep cribbing, and he said, son, find a way of enjoying what you're doing. How the hell can you enjoy audit? How can you enjoy, vouching? I don't know if some of you understand what that is. Just basically ticking that the numbers are right or totaling. Now, that was the job. And so I realized very early on, I think it was 17 or 18 at that time, when I realized that I was not really adding any value. I was becoming like a statutory parasite. And I would get hired because the law said so. So I shifted to tax. We didn't have a dad's firm didn't have a tax practice. So slowly I started that. I started enjoying going to the income tax appellate. I had rights of audience up to the tribunal. I would get there. How much time do I have? I can go on forever.
If we can start with when you started Luthra and Luthra.
I love this guy telling me now after. First he tells me, tell how you started your journey. I started that, just how you started. Okay. So I found lawyers who had no idea of tax. I would win the case generally in the income tax appellate tribunal, but generally get appealed, and these lawyers would mess up my case. I couldn't talk. So very late in life, I did my law when I was 31, while running the tax practice of my father's firm. And then I found tax also getting very corrupt, and it was all about who you know, not what you know. So I used to have a motorcycle those days, and I set up, took a little office in Barakamba Road, 1,500 square feet. And nothing much has changed, by the way. Even today, at that time also, you needed to have connections. I didn't have. I had no godfather, no godmother, no chief justice, uncle or cousin or whatever. So I really, but I knew a couple of things. I knew how things work in terms of how office systems work. Lawyers have very little knowledge of all that. They have no knowledge of balance sheets. So I could foresee a little bit of the future as to where it's going to go, and then India opened. So I got many accolades that I was the pure business law firm in India at that time. What a visionary. I didn't know anything else. So that was my vision. And I kept trying to build and try to see where the practice would go and then try and build the knowledge. So the same story that you hear now for startups, see if there's a need. And if you can fulfill that need, you will be successful. That's exactly what I did, not knowing this slogan, now I know. Then I came to Harvard Law School for 7 summers. Because in India at that time, it was very, very difficult to fail a law exam. Very difficult. And you weren't taught business law. The professors, they had no idea of business law. So I said, I'm going to lead a firm and run it. I better know the law, at least how the practice of law is. So I came 7 summers to Harvard Law. Young David Wilkins, who I blame for, you can blame him for what I'm, if anything you find wrong with me, he taught me, and a number of others. And that was a real learning experience. And there, from there on, we started Project Finance, M&A. We were the pioneers in a lot of that area, Project Finance particularly. And I'll tell you one quick last anecdote, and then you can ask questions. So there's a guy called George Soros. I'm sure all of you have heard of him. He came to India in 93 for 2 projects that he was sponsoring. One was the Pench Power Project in Madhya Pradesh. The other one was the Haldia Petrochemicals Project in Calcutta, near Calcutta. And he was choosing lawyers. So I was one of the first big deals that I did was the Coke thumbs up, Coke Parley transaction. I was for Parley. So got some fame there, and you know, it was one of the biggest deals in India at that time. So he probably called me for, that's why he must have called me to also interview me. During the interview, I still remember so clearly, he asked me 23 questions. 18 of them were straight no's, because nobody in India knew Project Finance. He looked at me and said, do you know what a PPA is? I'm thinking perpetual pain in the ass. You know, so I mumbled that out. He said, oh, you know. Which is a power purchase agreement, by the way, for the uninitiated. And so I said, might as well get up myself before he throws me out. So I was getting up, and George looks at his partner and says, he's our lawyer. So I said, George, you know, a dog gets confused to have mutton or ham. So I said, why? He says, Lutz, you're the first guy I have met in your country who knows what he knows and he knows what he doesn't know. And George loves to play father. So he got Gene Goodwillie of White & Case, who was the infrastructure practice internationally head, to be my co-counsel and come and live in India for about 3 or 4 weeks at a time. And we'd go to Bhopal for doing the Pench Power Project rotary phones, that's when I sucked in all the knowledge. He had nothing to do but sit with me at the Janwa Palace Hotel, and that's how I learned. And I would have my kids with me, training them. Last bit was my sister would call me the mother duckling with my baby ducklings waddling all over the place. And that's how I built the firm.
Great. That's an awesome story. And Muruga, what I know, you got married on matrimony.com. So is that the reason you launched a website, because you couldn't find anybody to get married to? Why did you launch that, and what's been your journey so far?
Okay. Thank you, Vishal. I would say I'm married through bharatmatrimony.com. It's not that I wanted to get married, started the website. I was working as a technology consultant in New Jersey. I wanted to do something on my own. It was late 90s, that point in time, internet was catching up, and I was not sure where to begin. Since I am from Tamil Nadu, I thought, let me do something targeting Tamil community living outside of India. As putting up various sections, matrimony was one such service. So I realized that many people are coming for this matrimony service. I realized, I think people want to get married, and when they want to get married, they want to get married to someone speaking the same language. Because the Tamil community website, it took 2.5 years for me to identify an opportunity in the matrimony while running the community website. Then decided to venture into exclusive matrimony service. That was the year 2000. I want to do only initially Tamil matrimony and Telugu matrimony. I said the same technology. So I said, let's launch service for all the Indians. The approach again took was language-based matrimony services like Marathi, Hindi matrimony, all under the brand bharatmatrimony.com. Thankfully, I got laid off. It was the .com bubble bust that happened. So I was settling between India and the USA. The good thing that I couldn't raise money. Right from the beginning, it was kept as a paid service. My initial subscription was, we are charging $10 for 1 year. Now that has become $93 for 3 months. So went back to India. Then people say, look, it won't be successful in India because Indians, we are, won't be comfortable putting so much information or getting married online. I started addressing all this problem. Then slowly business got scaled up. In 2006, again, we got first round of funding, then got second round of funding. Then the success of Bharat Matrimony, while the language-based matrimony services, I sense in India, people get married to people belong to a particular community. So I thought, it could be a potential opportunity as well as competition, because 95% of the Indian marriages are happening within the community. So that led to me launching something called communitymatrimony.com, 300-plus site. A site for every religion, like christianmatrimony.com, muslimmatrimony.com, etc. A site for every community, like Agarwal matrimony, Patel matrimony. So today, the community matrimony is the third largest matrimony service. Then you see progress. We realized, because our success has been the way we have segmented the matchmaking, like language-based, community-based, there's a rich and affluent people. And we launched, why not launch exclusive matchmaking service for the affluent people? We launched Elite Matrimony. Today, we charge $1,000 to $20,000 for subscriptions. By the way, guys from Harvard are a lot of demand. We have a lot of elite girls. And one day, the elite parents come and ask us, do you have guys from Harvard, MIT? So you guys are demand, because a lot of elite girls,
what are the
girls? Are you going to cost all these guys outside?
Yeah.
Building your database?
So, in fact, that's one of the reasons for me coming, so that I can get some potential groom. So then we launched assisted matchmaking. It's a personalized matchmaking service for people who are busy people. Our relationship manager take care of the matchmaking service. We also set up retail outlets across India, because Indian matchmaking, the parents are one of the people who get involved in the matchmaking. They are comfortable with the touch and feel. We have 150 company managed outlets across India where parents can walk in to these outlets and avail our matchmaking service. So that's why we expanded the matchmaking business. So now matchmaking, we are expanding into wedding services, which is a $54 billion highly unorganized venture. Currently, we have two ventures, matrimony photography and videography service. We take care of wedding photography, videography service. And we also currently piloting a service called Matrimony Bazaar. which is helping people to avail wedding services, where we charge a service fee to avail the wedding services, and we have signed up with the thousands of service providers. The people who want to get married, they can pick and choose what service they want to avail through us. They get a very good commission of availing the service through us. So that's a matrimony bazaar venture. For me, the challenges which I'd overcome was entrepreneur becoming CEO. The initial stage of entrepreneurship, most of the times, goes behind our core competent areas like technology and the product. As you progress, we have to let go some of the responsibilities so that you have time to manage all the aspects of business. Letting go was one of the biggest challenge. Then, as the business grows, we need to develop ourselves so that you could influence and empower and give the leadership to the team. So that's one of the things we need to continuously evolve. When the business evolves, that's something the entrepreneur also evolves so that we could manage the business effectively. Then, as the business grows, one of the other challenges is managing the growth and the profitability. So the request call for efficient operations, restructuring, all the things. So those are some of the challenges.
Can I hold that thought for a minute?
Yeah.
Maybe
sure.
if I can ask Abhiraj, you went into your entrepreneurship journey very early. You're effectively almost a poster child of, you know, when you started your company, you know, living a pretty cushy job at BCG. And there was a lot of startup, you know, phenomena happening in India in 2013, 14, when you essentially jumped into it. What was the motivation? And just, if you can reference to Muruga's question about letting go, are you there? Are you not there? Where are you in your journey effectively at this point of time, given that you're effectively 2 years from when you started?
Sure. So for the benefit of everybody, I'll quickly touch upon what Urban Club does. I think we're a slightly younger company than some of the others. So Urban Club is a marketplace for hiring trusted local and home services. We pretty much offer any and every service in India, ranging from plumbing, electricians, to beauticians, yoga trainers, about 80-odd services across 8 cities. To your question, Vishal, so my entrepreneurship journey, I think probably started in 2011 when I was graduating from business school. My founder is a very dear friend from IIT Kanpur, my undergraduate college, and we know each other from day one. So pretty much throughout business school, and I attended IIM Ahmedabad, we would have conversations where we said that, you know, he'd taken up a job, so he said, you know, the corporate world sucks and don't do it, and, you know, let's just start something. But I had a loan, so we actually really seriously considered starting a company immediately after me graduating from IIM Ahmedabad. But then I landed this job with BCG and I had a loan. So I told him, you know what, give me a couple of years, let me figure things out, and then we'll circle back. Incidentally, he also moved to BCG at that point of time. So we both coincided in BCG. And through 2011 to maybe end of 2013, we had a bunch of weekend conversations, all kinds of ideas that we would discuss that we could do. Most of them were very, very naive. I have absolutely nobody in my family who's done anything remotely related to business. So lots of naive ideas, but we weren't really making any progress. These were just talk. So about a couple of years into, you know, sort of ideating over weekends, I told him that, hey, look, you know, we aren't getting any younger. The Indian startup ecosystem is getting hot. And this is 2013, so people are selling everything online, from toothbrush to toothpaste, everything, there's a startup online. So then we quit. And when we quit, after that, Varun, my co-founder, he comes from a business background. His family runs you know, lots of factories. So his father was really interested to set up a factory for the two of us that we could run. In fact, he'd found a contract with Tata Tea for us to make some sort of a covering for their tea sachets. And he said that you should do it, and it's a big business. So I spent about 2 weeks with Varun. I think we visited 10 to 15 different factories. Somebody was making mosquito coils, somebody was making tin sheds, and with all due respect, great businesses. At the end of those 2 weeks, I said, okay, definitely not my cup of tea. I cannot run one of these companies. I also did not know how to code, extremely technologically challenged. Only when I started Urban Club did I buy my first smartphone. and started an app-based company. So I said, okay, let's do something in technology, but let's not do something even remotely related to anything online or anything that requires coding. We are both electrical engineers, so let's figure out some electrical device that we can make. So we actually, very quickly, what we ended up doing was we were taking this train journey to one of my friend's wedding, and we both said that this is a really boring journey, and there's no connectivity, and there's never going to be any connectivity, because, towers will only come up in urban areas. And so let's make a device which can be installed in trains, planes, and buses, which will create a local Wi-Fi loop and stream content. And this is going to be amazing because we can install it over all of these, buses, trains, and planes all over the world. And since we're electrical engineers, we can make this device. So we actually ended up making the device. We found a couple of guinea pig, transporters who bought into our idea and bought these devices, and we started running this company. And at the time, we thought that this was a fantastic idea and it was going to be the next big thing. And everybody who we met, by the way, said that it was a fantastic idea and it was going to be the next big thing. But long story short, about a year of running that business, we realized that it wasn't going anywhere. It was extremely complicated, lots of issues with content sourcing, and we shut it down. So I think that for me, this was 2014. That for me was the first realization of reality, because suddenly our first business had tanked. We had pretty much spent most of our savings into it. So we had little savings left now, and we had no line of sight of any new idea. And here was Varun and me basically sitting in my living room, wondering what to do next and realizing that we can fail. And just because we went to good colleges and worked at good companies doesn't mean that business is going to come to us naturally. At that point of time, I remember this one day when I'm just sitting and my wife had asked me to put up a couple of wall hangings. And I ordered, I basically called a carpenter from one of the local Yellow Pages. And this guy said, yes, I'm coming. And then he didn't show up. And then in the afternoon, I called somebody else. He said, yes, I'm coming. And he didn't show up. And in the evening, finally, somebody showed up without tools. At the end of the day, it was a weird experience because I said, hey, usually commerce will make it very easy for you to part with your money. Like, that's how all companies work. That's, they make it very, here am I, I'm willing to part with my dollars. It's a fairly straightforward service. What's wrong here? What's broken? And that got us thinking into the whole space of local and home services, which we then realized has, since the start of the internet, seen lots and lots of companies and lots of carcasses along the way. But somewhere we felt that this was inevitable, that there was sufficiently into the future, there was going to be an Amazon for services, that people would be able to hire trusted, high quality services at the push of a button. And we continue to believe in that vision. It's now almost 3 years that we've been building Urban Clap. To your last question, absolutely not. Like, I'm just getting started. This is the love of my life, and I think as long as I have this team, I'm eager and happy to continue building this company for the next 10-15 years. And the vision is very big, so I hope I can sort of stay true to it.
And Anuj, you spent from Abhiraj Singh technologically challenged, bought his first smartphone in 2014. You spent 10 years at Google before you decided to do something, came back from San Francisco into Bangalore from 5-minute drives to 50-minute drives. what motivated you essentially to do Lyft Space? And what's your story? And I believe you had a couple of pivots as part of the ongoing piece. So can you talk a little bit about your experience?
So since, firstly, thanks for having me over. I'll quickly explain what Lyft Space does so that you guys are all on the same page. It's a pioneering idea. Nobody's done it before us. So, and that's part of the motivation as well. In general, my co-founder and me really wanted to sort of do something which, honestly, nobody has ever done before. And that's sort of the other very interesting challenge that you have when you create pioneering approaches. LiveSpace is a home design, home interior design platform, and we service sort of two clients. So the consumer who has a home interior design and a renovation problem. Renovation is a huge use case here in the US. And so they get a full service end-to-end experience from the idea to the designer to products and services and the ultimate installation. And it's a huge value solve for the consumer. Along the journey, we realized that the market is so broken across the world, to be honest, and it's very artisanal in its instinct. It started largely from Italy, and most of the services are really done and facilitated by interior designers, small studios, and contractors and whatnot. The principal issue is that they are not well-staffed, right? So it's almost like before Uber, the taxi driver was very poorly staffed to provide the best possible services, which is why there were no cabs in San Francisco and New York at that point in time. So our realization was that if you can actually create an automation-driven approach for the designer, for small studios, for contractors and whatnot, then you're actually fundamentally solving a huge problem for this expert, the agent, to provide the best service for the client. Right? And believe you me, all these journeys, all these instincts to us came, as we sort of were building the business. As Vishal said, I spent about a decade in the Valley, most of it at Google. Murga, you won't know, but my first founder was a guy called Peng Ong. He built Match.com.
Wow. Okay.
So my question at that point, I was a young kid. My question to him was Peng, actually looking at you, you actually kind of needed a service because you were not getting any dating. So you clearly were sort of trying to solve your own problem. So he's a great guy, and we worked together for about 2 years. Sold the company to IBM. So I sort of saw at an early level an evolution of a technology-based approach. It was based in Redwood Shores in the broader valley. Joined Google right after, and which was, of course, a phenomenal journey. I used to work for the product and growth team there. And these corridors are very familiar to me because I used to come here recruit 9, 10, 11, those sort of days for the product managers and product marketing roles. We can talk separately about the Google journey, but the principal insight that I think those many years really at Google was to sort of see a company and the discipline with which they would build ideas, break it, take it from, I think you guys should read a book called, it's by Peter Thiel, it's 0 to 1, I think. So it's the hardest part for a product manager or an entrepreneur is really to sort of have an idea, which pretty much apart from them, few people believe in, and to take it from that sort of that level to its first early evolution, right? And, as someone who was in Google in those times, I saw the first clunky Android phones, and you'd remember it's such a behemoth right now. So sort of seeing that day in and day out and day in and day out, to see how pioneering technologies and approaches are sort of created from simple ideas to businesses and how you build teams around that. And Google in general worked like a conglomerate of startups, right? So you had an idea, you could actually pitch upwards. Larry and Sergey pretty much sort of kind of worked like VCs, right? So they would fund you initially, and then you sort of go from one stage to next stage. And a lot of people sort of miss the point that, I remember I think all of you guys must have read those articles where they said that lots of ideas fail at Google. The issue is that they would actually feed the winners, starve the losers, right? So you sort of saw all those interesting things wherein they'll put small amount of money, a couple million to 5 million, small people, small teams, amazing product managers, great sales and operations people, and give them $5 million each, and then it goes from there to the next level and so forth and so on. So you sort of saw that very early in my life. 2011, 12, I was bored skullless. I had no idea, spent so many time at Google. I was what the F am I doing with my life, right? So my friend, Ben Silberman, who you guys funded, Ben built Pinterest, great, great, great guy, married to a girl from Bangalore. So I think his departure from Google and doing all these things, and Abhiraj, his journey is very similar to yours. Lots of failures, lots of iterations, and eventually came upon Pinterest. And I think he used to work as my product specialist on AdSense. I think he inspired me to start thinking outside Google. I started actively angel investing. I was running commerce and mobile payments at Google, so the growth and product function. So I saw a lot of interesting entrepreneurs because none of that stuff used to work at Google that well. So we were acquiring companies, and so just sort of got closer to the investing, venture capital, that kind of functions, and really had no idea. So when I quit Google in 2013 end, I really quit without a job. It was that bored. I had no idea because you can't take up a job after that. I didn't think I had the chops to become a venture capitalist. And, I principally wanted to sort of create an idea or create a company which actually came from nowhere. we were doing our own apartment in San Francisco. My family has a deep interest in the commercial interior space. And my amazing co-founder sort of built a company called Mintra in India. So all of those various inspirations came together. And I thought that I've gone through a phenomenal evolution and seen sort of a massive amount of growth at one stage of my life. And that's very, very fortunate. India is going through a revolution. This is like 2013, 14, that time period. And if I am actually here with all my knowledge and not participating in this phenomenal entity called India, which will see a revolution in the next 2 to 3, 4 decades, I would be so stupid. So actually, honestly, my entry point into entrepreneurship was largely driven by a personal situation and sort of sitting here, seeing India evolving and just jumping into the company. I mean, and to answer the second thing that you actually mentioned, so pioneering idea, nobody was doing it. I couldn't copy anybody, right? So, and which is interesting. And that's a tough situation to be in. So when we started the company, we were literally like a full stack service. So imagine if Uber were to start manufacturing its own cars, right? So we were that stupid. So we were actually designing the products. We were working with factories to actually design it, assembling them, you know, in a virtual way through our technology and enabling homes. Now, the principal choke point in this idea are two, right? You become heavily supplier dependent. You become heavily industrial design dependent. Guess what? Both of those things were something that we didn't know. India is a supply side constrained country. So we learned very, very quickly. So first pivot was that, which is don't do your own design, one. Build a marketplace of, you know, services. So we did that, and that was a great idea. So we sort of spent about 6 to 7, 8, 9 months just building an assorted marketplace of furniture providers and decors and modular design to manufacturing contractors, blah, blah, blah. We're India's largest by far in terms of catalog depth and width. Along the journey, I think we realized that, as I was saying, all these ideas, believe you me, came to us because Ramakant and I, we used to continuously talk, like, and we still do actually, probably like talking even when I was coming in, because we're constantly brainstorming because honestly, the best thing that you can actually do to yourself is to find the best possible co-founder, right? So through one of those conversations, the whole home design automation platform idea came up, and we thought we were building pioneering technology. And through conversations again, this whole idea evolved, which is sort of the next iteration of the company.
And Vivek, when all this online stuff talked about in all the pink papers and, you know, every other place, you decided to build a brand, both offline and online. And what decided, you know, you kind of said, hey, I'm not going to get into this online journey necessarily. When a lot of things were happening around it, what inspired you to say, that's not what I'm going to do. I'm going to build a brand and build a quirky brand, which is pretty interesting. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So I think we started off somewhere with the idea, and 2009 is when we started working on it. So Anuj, about co-founder, extremely important. I agree, she's my wife. So, another story about how it started. But I think somewhere along the line, we realized that each time we went and traveled across the place, we'd pick up stuff that was, you know, representative of that country. And when we came back to India, we'd say, hey, why doesn't India have stuff that represents and shows stuff that represents India in its today's form? I think the kind of souvenirs that people got way back in 2009 were literally the same Pashmina shawls and the Taj miniature marble Taj Mahals. I think Genghis Khan probably took back the same souvenirs then as well. So I think that's what we decided that we needed to solve that problem. And one of the first things that we did, we bootstrapped back in 2009. We sold the house that we were living in and started Chumbak. And I think somewhere we realized that this entire online versus offline thing was secondary to, as you said, building brand. And from day one, we've always felt that, you know, it's not us who's deciding where, you know, I'm going to only have offline, only have online. I think it's what's important and what we've learned is that you go where the consumer goes. So today, if the consumer wants in the afternoon, is at work and wants to buy something online, you should have the best experience there available online. And in the evening, she's at a mall or somewhere and she wants to shop, you should be available there as well. So I think that was the entire hybrid omnichannel kind of approach that we took from day one, saying that one of the first things that we wanted to do was build this design-led lifestyle brand from within the country. And I think design plays a pretty small role in most, large startup journeys. And the thing from a saying that designing everything in-house versus what, I know you were mentioning, saying that why are we doing it in-house? I think that's core to what we do. And we started out with, a whole bunch of accessories. For the first 2 years, we retailed through offline and online, and not our own offline stores, but other mom-and-pop and departmental stores. And 2012 is when we realized that consumers were coming to us and said, hey, listen, it's been 2 years of Chumbak. We love your stuff, but we can't see all of Chumbak at one place. And that's when we decided, listen, we needed to go into this ourselves. Started smaller pop-up stores across the country, ended up opening about 40, 50 of them. When realizing that consumers were then coming to us and said that, hey, what's new at Chumbak and stuff like that, but would give us 1,000 rupees and say, give us something at Chumbak. And invariably, we'd give them 500 rupees back in change. So from a brand perspective, they were here, but we were servicing them somewhere here and clearly leaving money on the table. And that's when the first change happened back in 2014, when we decided that we needed to move away from the smaller pop-up kind of formats to large formats. So we went from like an average of 150 square feet stores to about 2,500 square feet stores. And definitely solved the money on the table problem. I mean, the average bill sizes went up like some 5x. And somewhere we realized that the other thing that needed to be done to close the loop after introducing home as a category was that we needed a lot more repeat purchases that we wanted to put up there. So we launched fashion. And I think today fashion is about, with accessories and all of that, it's about 60% of the business. And home is about 40. So I think somewhere one of the biggest challenges that we face and have as we grow also is that there are no stores, barring very few brands in the country, that look at design and in-house design as something that, as has to carry on and consumers shouldn't get bored of. From a product perspective, how am I able to manage merchandising dresses, cushion covers, plates and furniture in the same store? And I think, and with the fact that you're bound by 2,500 square feet kind of thing. So I think these are the things that we've kind of working on, and we're opening a bunch more of stores. So as you said, so retail offline is about 70% of the business, and Chumbak.com, which is our own site, it accounts for the rest 30. We're very, very tiny on marketplaces. I think one of the few brands in the country that are not able to figure out why we can't sell on marketplaces, but we're able to bring out a huge number of people to our own site.
And just, taking off from, the marketplaces and some profitability questions, there's been a lot of noise over the last 12, 18 months about sustainability of some of these businesses, given the amount of capital that they've raised, several billion dollars in few cases. How do they get to profitability? Is there a real path to profitability? So Rajiv, you have seen a lot of these, some of these entrepreneurs in your journey as counsel to several of them. What do you make of the best practices that some of these entrepreneurs have that allows companies to sustain not for 5 years or 7 years, but are multi-decade companies in terms of where they're going to be and continue to be leader in their space?
Okay, let me just try and put this in a different perspective. This is nothing which is, it's not new. In the early 90s, we had this race for power projects in India. Every panwala of some substance had an MOU signed with some government to set up a power project. And, they didn't know the spelling of, power projects, etc., but they were all doing that. And there was a huge race for it. In fact, one state had 280 MOUs signed in 17 days for roughly almost 1 gigawatt of power at that time. And that time, the cost of a megawatt was probably a few million dollars. Anyway, then came the deathcom period, where we had crazy valuations. And it was all over the place, and suddenly all of that died, barring one or two that survived, maybe. I'm exaggerating. Now is this new startup story that's come in and it's become a huge mantra. You pick up a stone, you'll find two people waving at you. Rajiv, uncle, I'm just starting a startup. Or Rajiv, my son is just doing that. And it's become absolutely an epidemic. My one concern is if everybody's doing startups, who's going to work in them? So I think we need to look at that a little bit. So now on coming back to sustenance and what really I've seen, let me try and put it in a kind of a formula. I like to do that normally, even though I'm a lawyer. If you believe in your idea and that idea has a need that you're fulfilling, my view is that the need, whose need you fulfill will make sure you succeed. Now, if you have a larger number of people's need that you fulfill, you'll have, it's not only about blessings, it's about crowdsourcing, crowdfunding, crowd knowledge, all of that stuff starts to fall in place. I mean, I'm also one of the founders of the Indian Angel Network in India, and I've personally made about 37, 38 investments, small ones, just to look at this whole ecosystem going. Our own firm, we have a nationwide team of lawyers who focus only on startups. When I get these so-called shareholders, I'm just an investor, say, in the Indian Angel Network system, I find them all one-sided, against the interest of the founder. And I always go back, and much to the irritation of my co-investors, I go back and say, look, this is not right, because it won't sustain. The guy will quit, and he'll start something else. So, you know, important thing is, there has to be the agendas clear from all parties. Even the founders, the guy, they must believe in that and they must be able to sustain it. So sustaining an idea is very, very important. Therefore, you must get people who are investing with you with the same agenda. You know, someone to flip, use closed-ended funds. All that space has to be understood well, is my view.
And Muruga, you were briefly adhering to this when you said, I had no choice because I didn't get capital early on, so I had to start charging the customer early on. But there's a lot of chat about, hey, how do you get hooked the customer early on? And you do that by significant, you know, basically giving away freebies. What's your journey on profitability, and how do you think about that?
It's a good thing that because when we started the venture in 2000, you know, we got a first round of funding only in 2006. So right from the beginning, we were able to scale up the business without raising any capital. In fact, post raising a first round of funding, when we did a lot of the work that current starts of doing, within a year, we were able to burn all the money. And then we luckily got a second round of funding. And thankfully that slowdown happened. You know, there was a recession in 2009 period. I think that's what the board gave the direction that you had to become profitable again, so which was a challenging period. I think that's a period the entrepreneur became a CEO in my case. I went to each and every aspect of the business and realized how efficiently company can be run. Since then, no looking back. Part of the challenge was how to manage both the growth and the profitability. So that's one of the reasons we are able to create more matchmaking businesses, because what we started at the Bharat Matrimony, we were able to create multiple matchmaking businesses. That's helped us to grow. Now, because India, there are around 55 million people are looking for a life partner. Currently, around 5 million people are online. So it takes some time to get more people to come online. In the meantime, to manage the growth, we are also getting into the newer venture like Matrimony Photography and other venture without losing a lot of money. As far as how to balance between the growth and profitability, at the same time driving the efficiency, that's called for taking tough decision, like restructuring, many other things. So it's a growth and running the business efficiently and all that. So at the same time, keeping the core business intact.
And Anuj and Abhiraj, you are fairly early in your journeys as entrepreneur, and your companies are young. How do you think about the growth versus profitability conundrum and capital? All those three are, you know, like a three-legged stool. How do you think about that? Maybe Abhiraj, you can start, and then Anuj.
Yeah, I think, so I remember the last lecture of business school, I had this professor who said that, you know, if you can forget everything that was taught here and just remember one thing, then that is never run out of cash. Because as long as you have cash, you are alive and you will fight another day. But if you run out of cash, you're dead. I think for us, that's something that, and obviously Urban Club is not profitable right now, but that's something that we think about very deeply. We, at any given point of time, have a plan for what we like to call the nuclear winter, which is to say that, hey, next 3-4 years, if there's no sort of funding coming in, how do we still run the company profitably, and how do we still continue to grow the company on the back of real revenues? And I think that's really important. We've also been super frugal as a startup from the get-go. You know very well, Vishal, for a very long time, as founders, we drew hardly any salary. You know, our team, including myself, when we travel to different cities, on most occasions, I will not take a hotel. I will sleep in our city office. I continue to do that. So I think one should sort of never forget the core aspect of business, which is keeping costs low, and the reason why you're doing business is to generate profits. Now, you, as a business model, some businesses generate profits immediately, some take time, depending upon the kind of business that you're in, one has to sort of pave that journey. But it's extremely important, and I definitely see a lot of startups, not just in India but in the Valley as well. There's a splurge of funding, money. There's little focus on profitability, on growing the company in a sustainable way, and I don't subscribe to that. I think it's very important to sort of keep profitability in mind and always have a clear path to profitability.
Anuj?
Sure, yeah. And to be honest, like, I think coming from the background that I think both my co-founder and I come from, the only two things that I think both of us know is you build a company and take it to scale and drive profitability. And the other thing, as Abhiraj said, poor capitalization can actually kill the best ideas very, very quickly, right? So it's an odd situation that you are in, wherein you're actually trying to balance the need for growth, profitability, and making sure that you're, you know, working with the right kind of investors and dilution and whatnot. So less known, we're actually the largest in our space in India by now, right? And scale sometimes actually is the best way to drive profitability. So the two or three core principles that I think we realized very, very early is that if they're like at an economic level, if you see any idea has supply side parameters and demand side parameters, right? The only few things that you can actually do as an entrepreneur, you're okay, ensure the best possible customer experience, put the best possible supply side inputs, and really, really, really dramatically aim for order level profitability. Luckily, the business that we are in is actually solving a pertinent need. You can actually be profitable. So we have massive order level profitability, and Vishal, sort of, you know that. The right challenge for us is, as I said, get to scale in the best possible, most responsible manner, right? Which is sustaining that specific curve. So it's not a bad idea if you're not growing 10 times a year. It's actually okay to grow at 3x the pace, and that's good enough. Because then that'll actually allow you the right kind of burn method, the right kind of scale to actually drive supply side profitability. The moment that happens, I think the equation is balanced. But you know, we keep tweaking these three variables as we sort of go along.
So Anand's saying, I think we are run out of time. I know there may be a bunch of Q&As for all the panel members. My request, we can do it just outside because there's another event that's going to come here. So maybe we can just step outside and all these folks will be available for you to talk to about their respective businesses. Thank you. Thanks to all of you.